In radio and television, it's RCA all the way. The Radio Corporation of America presents The Magic Key. Your host, the family of RCA, whose members include RCA Laboratories, RCA Communications, Radio Marine, RCA Victor, and the National Broadcasting Company. Magic Key turns, bringing you a world of radio entertainment in all its infinite variety. From the Metropolitan Opera Company, the brilliant young prima donna, Marjorie Lawrence. From the American stage, the distinguished actress, EVA LLEGALIAN. From the field of popular music, the swing and sway of Sammy Kaye. From the world of foolish fun, Howard and Shelton. And the entire program musically woven together by our own conductor, Frank Black. The Magic Key Orchestra strikes a happy note as we hear the Merrymakers dance from Edward German's Nell Gwynn Suite. In 6 short years, Marjorie Lawrence, prima donna of the Metropolitan Opera Company, has become one of the outstanding singers of our time. Today, we shall have an opportunity to hear for ourselves the reason for this sensational rise to fame as the Magic Key presents Marjorie Lawrence. Miss Lawrence, exclusive Victor recording artist, sings Cleopatra's air from Handel's opera Julius Caesar.
Thank you.
Thank you, Miss Lawrence. We shall be waiting for your return later in the program. In a moment of inspiration, a poet once said, "Of all sad words human tongue can tell, the saddest of all, farewell, farewell." Here is a scene of sad farewell which might have happened to any of us, and probably has. But before our emotion becomes too great, let us present the participants in this little heart-throbbing threnody. Introducing now, as reverse English tragedians, those funny favorites, Tom Howard and George Shelton.
Well, here we are, George.
May I tell our friends that we are in a suburban railway station. Shelton has just spent 2 weeks at Howard's home, and Howard is now seeing a woman. Go on, Tom and George.
Boy, we got to the station before Grauer did that time, eh, George?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's nice for you to see me off to the train, Tom.
Oh, that's all right. What time does your train leave, George?
3:50.
Uh-huh.
Let me see. I think I got about 10 minutes.
What time is it now?
Wait, I can't get my coat open. Yeah, I got it. 4:20.
Yeah, you got 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, say, you don't have to wait, Tom. Maybe you got something to do.
Oh, no, that's all right. I'm in no hurry.
Well, gee, I had a great time, Tom.
Yeah.
See, I want to thank you for all you did, too. Mrs. Howard was sure swell.
Oh, that's all right, George. Glad you enjoyed yourself.
Yeah, I had a great time. Sure did.
Yeah, glad you did, George.
Yeah. Sure did, yeah.
Yeah, I'm glad. What time is it now, George?
It's wait, I see. It's 4:18 now.
Mm-hmm. You got 8 minutes yet.
Yeah. Say, maybe you got something to do, huh?
Oh, no. I'm in no hurry.
Well, I don't want to keep you, you know.
Oh, that's all right. I'm glad to see you leave. On such a nice day.
Yeah.
You know, it sure is a nice day to be leaving on. You know what I mean, you see?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a swell day.
Yeah.
Yeah, swell.
Don't forget, drop us a line when you get home.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Pretty nice station you got here, huh?
Yeah, kind of quaint, isn't it?
I think so.
Yeah.
They keep it nice.
Yeah. It has heat in the wintertime, George.
No kidding.
Yeah.
I think I'll come out some winter and see what it's like.
Well, I wouldn't come all the way out here just for that.
They use a lot of station wagons around here, don't they, huh?
Oh, yeah, quite a lot.
Well, I suppose they're very handy.
Yeah, they are very handy.
Yeah, I guess they're very handy.
Yeah. What time is it?
Oh, wait a minute. Let me see. It's 4:15.
Oh, train should be here pretty soon.
Yeah, about 5 minutes.
Don't the time drag when you're... Pardon me. Yeah. I was going to say, don't the time drag when you're waiting.
Yes, it sure does.
Why
don't you run along, Tom? I can get along all right.
Oh, don't be silly. I don't mind waiting. It's only 5 minutes.
I don't want to keep you, though.
Oh, it's all right.
Sure is a nice day, though, isn't it, huh?
Yeah. Fine. Fine day.
Oh, say, don't forget and tell Mrs. Howard what a great time I had.
No, I won't, George.
I don't know when I enjoyed myself so much.
Yeah. They're putting the gates down. That must be your train, George.
I guess it is. My watch must be slow.
Yeah.
Well, so long, Tom.
Goodbye, George. Take care of yourself.
I will. Now, don't forget and tell Mrs. Howard.
I will.
Well, goodbye.
Goodbye.
So long.
So long, George.
So long, Tom.
Don't forget.
There she goes.
Yeah. Boy, she sure does. There she went all right, George.
Well, that's not my train.
No. If it is, you missed it.
Yeah.
Well, next train will be yours, I hope. I guess the next one will be yours.
Why don't you go ahead, Tom? I only have a few minutes.
Oh, don't be silly. I don't mind waiting. What time is it?
Oh, gee, that's it. Well, it's 12 minutes to 4 now.
Yeah, should be here any minute now.
Yeah, should be.
Didn't forget anything, did you, Joy?
No, I got everything.
You won't forget to come down again when you get a chance.
No, thanks, Tom, I sure will. I get a great kick out of seeing you and Mrs. Howard, you know.
Well, we'd like to have you.
Yeah, I always have a swell time. And Mrs. Howard sure is swell.
Yeah, we always have a nice time.
Yeah. That sure is swell.
Mm. Yeah. What time you got?
I mean, pizza.
What time will you get home?
About 8 o'clock.
Where's your bag?
I don't know. Wait, here, I got it right here.
Didn't see it.
Yeah. Sure, I'm not keeping you.
Oh, no, not at all. Not at all, George.
Wonder what's the matter with that train.
What time is it?
What time is it? It's 10 minutes to 4 now.
Should be here by now.
Yeah, it should.
Maybe it's late.
You think so? Say, my watch may be a little fast.
I wonder what's keeping it.
Why don't you go ahead, Tom? I'll wait.
Oh, I'm in no hurry, George. I
hate to bother you like this, though.
What do you mean, bother? Here she comes now, George.
Yeah, well, goodbye, Tom. Goodbye. Mrs. Howard, Tom.
Yeah, I will. Take care of yourself,
well,
George.
Well, so long.
So long. Drop us a line.
I sure will. So long, Tom.
So long.
What was that?
Looks like we're a little premature there.
Can you imagine putting the gates down for one of those little hand cars?
So I'm sure that was your train.
Yeah.
What time is it?
Yeah, your time. Oh, yes, yeah. It's 9 minutes to 4 now. Yeah. Hey, you better go ahead, Tom. I'll wait here alone.
Oh, it can't be much longer. I'm in no hurry, George.
Well, I sure had a good time.
Yeah. Yeah, it was nice having you.
Mrs. Howard sure was swell, Tom.
I'm glad you enjoyed yourself.
Yeah.
That must be at this time, right?
Yeah.
Well, I certainly hope it is. I mean, I guess that's
yours. Yeah, that's her.
Yeah, just a minute. I'm not taking any chances.
New York train. Port.
Yeah, I guess it's okay. Well, so long, George. Take care of yourself.
I will, Tom.
Don't forget to drop us a line.
And don't forget to tell Mrs. Howard.
I will.
Well, goodbye.
Goodbye.
I had a great time.
I'm glad you did. So long.
So long, Tom.
So long.
So long.
Thank heavens that guy's gone.
George Abbott's rewrite of Shakespeare, combined with the music of Rodgers and Hart, has made The Boys from Syracuse one of New York's favorite attractions. Now Frank Black makes a further contribution to the entertainment as he conducts the Magic Key Orchestra in his own arrangement of the show's hit tune, I'm Falling in Love with Love. Thank you.
National Broadcasting Company takes pride in calling to your attention a letter from Greta Challenberg of Florida about the broadcasts of the NBC Symphony Orchestra. Maestro Arturo Toscanini, care National Broadcasting Company, Radio City, New York. Dear Maestro, there is a little group in the extreme southeastern part of the United States, out on the coral reefs, isolated and far from railroads and resources of a cultural nature. These people have formed a club called the Key West Music Guild for the purpose of listening to your NBC broadcasts. Of necessity, the hour of meeting has to be late, but they gather at a somewhat earlier hour so as to be able to discuss the numbers you will play and thus be in a position to appreciate them better. Many people in Key West seize every opportunity to improve themselves, and your broadcasts are a godsend to the population, hungry for the best in music. The Key West Music Guild was formed by leaders in the Federal Music Project. Are there not times when you wonder where and how people are listening to your wonderful music? Well, this is one place, and one earnest, eager little group who could not be more sincere in their admiration. It must be a joy to know how constructive your work really is. That is my excuse for writing. God bless you and give you strength to carry on.
No star is lost.
And this lovely thought vocally expressed by Tommy Ryan.
No star is lost up in the blue divine. Some other time, some other place they shine. We look and wonder as they go under, while on through years and years they're tossed. No star is lost. Kiss me again, my own, and leave me never. For in my arms alone, our love is forever. No star is lost, for nature knows a thing. After the winter comes the rose of spring. Fate may divide us, but love will guide us. One moment's chill is not an endless frost. No star is lost.
New hit just recorded by Victor with Sammy Kay and his Swing and Sway, in which Sammy assumes the role of a daddy talking to his little lad.
Lay aside your cares.
say the prayers that your mommy taught to you. Little lad, you're crying. Little lad, you're blue. I know why you're crying. Mommy's not with you. Now don't cry. Close your eyes and go to sleep. Little lad, I miss her, as I know you do. Why, Daddy longs to kiss her, just the same as you. Now don't cry, close your eyes and go to sleep. Soon you'll be drifting to dreamland, where playmates wait for you. And all of the little things you plan, why, the Sandman, he'll make them come true. Though she's not beside you, yet from up above, Mommy's there to guide you, giving you her love. Now don't cry, go to sleep, my little lad. Beside you, yet from up above, our mommy's there to guide you, giving you her love. Now don't cry, go to sleep, my little lamb.
From the world of popular music, the Magic Key takes you now into the realm of the theater. The play, A Sunny Morning, a delicate and facile little comedy from the Spanish of the Quintero brothers. The star, the distinguished American actress, Miss EVA LEGALIAN, assisted today by H. Cooper Cliff. The Magic Key presents EVA LEGALIAN. The scene, a bright sunny morning in the corner of a park in old Madrid. Approaching a brightly painted bench and leaning on the arm of her maid is Doña Laura, a handsome white-haired lady of about 80. Doña Laura, played by Miss LEGALIAN, speaks.
I'm so glad to be here. I was afraid my bench would be occupied. What a beautiful morning.
The sun is too hot.
Oh, yes, to you who are only 20. I feel more tired today than usual. Oh, run along if you want to chat with your guard.
He's not mine, Signora. He belongs to the park.
He belongs more to you than he does to the park. Go and find him, but remain within calling distance. Wait a moment, Petra.
What does the Signora wish?
Well, you've forgotten to give me my breadcrumbs.
Here, Signora.
Ah. Adios. Ah, here come my birds. They know just when to expect me. These are for the spryest, these are for the gluttons, and these are for the littlest ones who are the biggest rogues of all.
Those priests, idling that time away, they should be saying mass.
You can sit here, Señor. There is only a lady.
I won't want you. I want a bench to myself.
But there is none.
That one over there is mine.
There are three priests sitting there.
Well, rout them out. Have they gone?
No, indeed. They are talking.
Just as if they were glued to the seat. No hope of their leaving. Oh, come on, Juanito.
Look out.
You addressing me, Signora?
Yes, you.
What do you want?
Well, you frightened away my birds.
Oh, what do I care about the birds?
But I do.
This is a public park.
Then why do you complain that the priests have taken your bench?
Signora, we've not met, and I cannot understand why you take the liberty of addressing me. Come on, Leto.
Ah, disagreeable old man. Why is it some people must get so fussy and cross when they reach a certain age? I'm glad he's lost that bench, too. Serves him right for scaring the birds. He's furious. Oh, poor man, he's wiping the perspiration from his face. Here he comes. A carriage couldn't raise more dust than he does with his feet.
Well, the priest's gone yet, Juanito?
No, indeed, senor. They are still there.
Well, the authorities should place more benches here for these sunny mornings. Well, I suppose I must resign myself and sit on the bench with the old lady. Good morning.
Oh, you here again?
I repeat that we've not met.
You should have asked permission to sit on this bench, which is mine.
The benches here are public property?
I thought you said the one the priests are sitting on was yours.
Very well, very well. I have nothing more to say. Senile old lady. She ought to be at home knitting, counting her beads.
Now, don't you grumble anymore. I'm not going to leave just to please you.
If the ground was sprinkled a little, it would be an improvement.
You use your handkerchief as a shoe brush, do you?
Well, why not?
Do you use your shoe brush as a handkerchief?
What right have you to criticize my actions?
A neighbor's right.
Ah, Juanito, my book. I don't care to listen to nonsense.
Well, you're very polite, I must say.
Here, senor.
Fine. Now, my glasses, Juanito, and my magnifier.
I thought you were going to take out a telescope next.
Oh, you again?
Your eyesight must be keen.
Keener than yours is.
That's evident.
Ask the hares and partridges.
Oh, you hunt, do you?
Oh, yes, Signora. Every Sunday I take my gun and dog and go to one of my estates near Aravaca and kill time.
Kill time. That's all you can kill.
Oh, do you think so? I could show you a wild boar's head in my study.
Well, I could show you a tiger skin in my boudoir. What does that prove?
Oh, very well, very well. Please allow me to read. First, I shall take a pinch of snuff. Will you have some?
Is it good?
It's of the very finest. Mmm, you'd like it.
Clears my head.
And mine.
Do you sneeze?
Yes, Senora, three times.
So do I. What a coincidence.
There. I feel better.
So do I.
You'll excuse me if I read aloud.
Oh, read as loud as you like. You won't disturb me.
All love is sad. But sad as it is the best thing that we know. That's from Campo Amor.
Yeah.
There are some beautiful poems in this book. Here. 50 years pass. He returns.
You can't imagine how it affects me to see you reading with all those glasses.
Can you read without any?
Certainly.
What, at your age? You're jesting.
Pass me the book, then. 50 years pass. He returns. And each beholding the other exclaims, "Can it be that this is he? Heavens! Is it she?"
I envy you your wonderful eyesight.
I know every word by heart.
I'm very fond of good verses. Very fond. I even composed some in my youth.
Good ones?
Of all kinds. I was a great friend of Zorilla. I first met him in America.
Oh, you've been to America?
Oh, several times. The first time I went, I was only 6 years old. Oh,
you must have gone with Columbus in one of his caravels.
Well, not quite as bad as that. I am old, I admit, but I didn't know Ferdinand nor Isabella. I was also a great friend of Campoamor. I met him in Valencia. I'm a native of that city.
Oh, you are?
Yes. I was brought up there, and there I spent my early youth. Have you ever visited that city?
Yes, indeed, senor. Not far from Valencia, there was a villa that, if still there, should retain memories of me. I spent several seasons there, many, many years ago. It was near the sea, hidden away among lemon and orange trees. They called it, what did they call it now? Maricella.
Ah, Maricella.
Yes, is the name familiar to
you? Oh, very familiar. If my memory serves me right, for we forget as we grow old, there lived in that villa the most beautiful woman I've ever seen. And I assure you I've seen many. Let me see, what was her name? Laura Lorente.
Laura Lorente?
Yes?
Nothing. You're speaking of my best friend.
Oh, how strange.
It is strange, Senor. She was called the Silver Maiden.
Precisely, the Silver Maiden. By that name, she was known in that locality. I seem to see her as if she were before me now. At that window with the red roses. Do you remember that window?
Oh, indeed. It was the window of her room.
Yes, she spent many hours there. I mean, in my day.
And in mine.
Ah, she was ideal. Fair as a lily. Jet black hair, black eyes, with an uncommonly sweet expression. She seemed to cast her radiance wherever she was. Her figure was beautiful, perfect. What forms of sovereign beauty God models in human clay. Ah, she was a dream.
She was very unfortunate and had a sad love affair.
Very sad.
Did you hear it?
Oh, yes.
Of the duel?
Precisely. The duel. The gallant lover was my cousin, of whom I was very fond.
Oh, your cousin.
Yes.
My friend told me in one of her letters the story of that affair, truly romantic. He, your cousin, passed by on horseback every morning down the rose path under her window and tossed up to her balcony a bouquet of flowers which she caught.
And later in the afternoon, the gallant horseman would return by the same path and catch the bouquet of flowers that she would toss to him. Am I right?
Yes. They wanted to marry her off to a merchant whom she would not have.
And one night, when my cousin waited under her window to hear her sing, this other person presented himself unexpectedly.
And insulted your cousin.
There was a quarrel.
And later a duel.
Yes, at sunrise on the beach. And the merchant was badly wounded. Himself for a few days and later to fly.
You seem to know the story very well.
So do you.
I explained to you that my friend repeated it to me.
Yes, as my cousin did to me.
Was it by any chance you who advised your cousin to forget Laura?
Why, my cousin never forgot her.
Well, how then do you account for his conduct?
Well, I'll tell you. The young man took refuge in my house, fearful of the consequences of a duel with a person highly regarded in that locality. From my home, he went to Seville, then came to Madrid. He wrote Laura many letters, some of them in verse.
Oh.
But undoubtedly they were intercepted by her parents, for she never answered at all. Gonzalo then, in despair, believing his love lost to him forever, joined the army, went to Africa, and there in a trench met a glorious death, grasping the flag of Spain and whispering the name of his beloved Laura.
What an atrocious lie.
I couldn't have killed myself more gloriously.
Well, you must have been prostrated by the calamity.
Oh, yes, indeed, Senora. As if he were my brother. I presume, though, on the contrary, that Laura in a short time was chasing butterflies in her garden, indifferent to regret.
Oh, no, indeed, Senor.
Oh, it's woman's way.
Well, even if it were a woman's way, the Silver Maiden was not of that disposition. My friend awaited news for days, months, a year, and no letter came. And one afternoon, just at sunset, she was seen to leave the house and with quickening steps wend her way toward the beach where her beloved had risked his life. She wrote his name on the sand, then sat down upon a rock, her gaze fixed upon the horizon. The waves murmured their eternal threnody and slowly crept toward the rock where the maiden sat. The tide rose with a boom and swept her out to sea.
Good heavens.
The fishermen of that shore, who often tell the story, they affirm that it was a long time before the waves washed away that name written on the sand. You won't get ahead of me.
she lies better than I do.
Ah, poor Laura.
Poor Gonzalo.
How curious fate is. Here are you and I, complete strangers, met by chance, and in discussing the romance of old friends of long ago, we have been conversing as if we were old friends.
Yes, it is curious, considering the ill-natured prelude to our conversation.
Oh, you scared away the birds.
Well, I was unreasonable, well, perhaps.
That was
I...
evident. Are you coming again tomorrow?
Oh, most certainly, if it's a sunny morning, and not only will I not scare away the birds, but I'll bring a few crumbs.
Thank you very much. Birds are grateful and repay attention. I wonder where my maid is. Petra?
No, I'll not reveal myself. I'm too old now. Better that she recall the gallant horseman who passed daily beneath her window, tossing flowers.
Ah, here she comes. No, I'll not tell him. I'm too sadly changed. Better he should remember me as the black-eyed girl tossing flowers as he passed among the roses in the garden. Well, Petra, at last.
Juanito, you're late.
The guard gave me these violets for you, Senora.
Oh, how very nice. You must thank him for me. They are fragrant.
My dear lady, this has been a great honor and a great pleasure.
It's also been a pleasure for me, Senora.
Well, goodbye until tomorrow.
Until tomorrow.
If it's a sunny morning.
If it is a sunny morning. Will you go to your bench?
No, I'll come to this, if you don't object.
This bench is at your disposal.
And I'll surely bring the crumbs.
Tomorrow, then?
Tomorrow.
What are you doing, Senor?
Juanito, wait. These violets, I must pick them up.
Can it be that this is he?
Heavens, is it she?
Celebrated young prima donna of the Metropolitan Opera Company, Marjorie Lawrence, returns to our microphone to sing again. This time, Miss Lawrence sings for us Zweignung by Richard Strauss. As an encore in a lighter vein, Marjorie Lawrence sings the 18th century English ballad, Doon the Burn.
Call.
When Marjorie Lawrence first appeared as Salome in the Richard Strauss opera at the Metropolitan last year, she created a stir in the music world by virtue of her masterly performance. Fortunately, Miss Lawrence is included in the distinguished list of Metropolitan stars whose voices are immortally inscribed on Victor Records for you to enjoy when you please. Even as with great operatic artists, so with RCA Victor Radios and Victrolas, they fill the roles for which they are designed and fill them with distinction. Whether to bring glorious symphony music into the most luxurious of homes or swing music into the dormitory room of the college student. Yes, RCA Victor instruments are designed to satisfy every taste, meet every pocketbook. Indeed, prices are so low compared to a few years ago that we can say without exaggeration, the 37 million radios in American homes today are not enough. Today, you can put an RCA Victor radio in every room in your home for the same amount that a single living room model cost not so long ago. We point with particular pride to the new RCA Victor Little Nipper radios, which you can purchase for as low as $9.95. Visit your RCA Victor dealer tomorrow.
Thank you.
Oxford Street March from the London Again Suite by Eric Coates. The members of the family of RCA, RCA Victor, RCA Laboratories, RCA Communications, Radio Marine, and the National Broadcasting Company invite you to tune in again next Sunday for another full hour of radio entertainment. At that time, you will hear as our prima donna, that international idol of the opera, movies, radio, and the concert stage, Grace Moore. A special feature with Alexander Wolcott, the town crier, in an anniversary appreciation of Abraham Lincoln. The astonishing performance of the twin pianos of Joyce Paul and Byron Janis, each 10 years old. The down-south harmonies of the J. Rosamond Johnson Choir and Frank Black conducting the Magic Key Orchestra. Milton Cross speaking for all the services of the Radio Corporation of America.
And Ben Grauer saying that in radio and television, it's RCA all the way.
This is the National Broadcasting Company.